how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and won me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing, and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Good morning. We have a few announcements before we get on with our service. We'd like to take this moment to welcome everyone that's come out today, especially our visitors. So if you are a visitor and you have come for the first time, obviously, and you didn't receive a welcome packet on the way in, please stop by the Welcome Center, fill out a card, and receive a free gift. We do not take up offerings at Lakeside. We have metal boxes by each sanctuary door, so please place your tithes and offerings in those on the way out. Anyone that's going to the Toledo Mud Hens game Friday, August 24th, please see Bob Weaver or Bob Powers today if you're interested. Also, the money for this event is due by next Sunday. If you plan on paying by check, please make out the check to Lakeside Travelers. Also, today is the last day to turn in recipes for the Joy Club cookbook that's coming up. All recipes are welcome from everybody, so make sure you turn those in. They are due, though, by August 1st, so I would hope that you would turn those in. Oh, sorry, the end of August. But there are forms in the back at the Welcome Center if you would like to pick up a form and submit a recipe. They certainly would appreciate that. Also, today, right after service, over here, there's going to be a meeting for the Ark Encounter and Creation Museum trip that's coming up next week. And tonight after service, there is an afterglow for the youth. They're going to have pizza, chips, pop, fun. You won't know what else is planned unless you come out and take place. So thank you, everyone. These and other announcements are in your bulletin.
Going to sing our praise and worship song this morning. It's Jesus Messiah. So let's get our lyrics out. The beautiful song.
Hang on a second. Everyone stay standing for a second. I think we can afford a couple more minutes to sing that again. Because I don't know about you, but there is no better name than the name of Jesus. When you think about that song, think about the things that it's talking about. He came for my sorry soul and for all of our sorry souls. Because let's just get honest with each other, that without Jesus, there is no other way. Man. And if we can't come to church and praise him, we're not here for us. I'm not here to have a good time for me. I'm not here to be entertained. I'm here to entertain the master. Amen. I'm here to bend his ear a little bit about how thankful I am for my sorry soul having a way to go to heaven. So I say let's sing that one more time. What about you? I know this is tough when you guys get put on the spot, but think about how great God is.
Amen.
You woke up this morning because of him.
That's right.
You came to church for Jesus.
Amen.
You didn't come to church for me.
That's right.
I know you didn't come here for me because I ain't that good looking. We're here for, let's just be honest, Pastor ain't either. We're not running close seconds here. But in all seriousness, let's sing that one more time and sing it like you mean it. Is Jesus really your Messiah?
That's
is
right.
Is he really the one who
That's
saved
right.
your soul?
Amen.
He is mine. So let's sing it one more time.
Who knew no sin, he might become his right.
Good morning. It's good to be in God's house this morning, isn't it? I'd rather be here than the best hospital in the state. There's no better place to be. Maybe I'm a little prejudiced, but it's a great place to be this morning. We're so thankful for y'all that are visiting this morning that you've came out. Hope that something will be said and done today that you'd come back and you'll find out how good of a place this really is. And before we start our service, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer and ask his blessing upon the service. Precious Father, we're so thankful for the time that you've already granted us within your mighty hand. God, I pray for those that are going to be sitting under the sound of the preaching this morning. God, I pray that you'd stir hearts and touch lives. I pray that you'd bind the arms of Satan and not let him get one single grasp inside this building. God, I pray for those who don't know you as their personal Savior that'll be listening today. God, I pray that you'd stir their hearts so heavy that they could understand the real, true meaning of coming to know you. God, I pray that you'd give Pastor strength, give him the wisdom that he needs as he comes before you, that you'd give him not only physical strength, but the mental and spiritual courage that he needs to deliver your word. And we'll be careful to give you the praise and glory for all that's said and done. In your precious name, amen.
Reason I'm looking around, it was somebody that for a few weeks we've been trying to coordinate to join the church officially, and I thought I saw him this morning, but I don't see him right now. If you're here, don't you let me forget that at the end of the message, if you would. If you have your Bibles this morning, may I invite you to Isaiah chapter 35, 35th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Good place to be this morning, is it not? Glad I'm saved, glad I'm on my way to heaven, glad I got a desire to serve the Lord along the way, and hopefully and prayerfully, if that's not your testimony this morning, it will be before you leave this place today. The most important decision you'll ever make in your life is the decision to accept Christ into your life. A lot of folks believe that that's foolishness. Even the scripture said it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that would believe. Now, that's not foolish preaching, but it's foolish in a way that we'd have to plead with folks to come to Jesus. If I had a dreaded disease and the doctors had told me that I didn't have much time left, and if I were made contact with somebody that says, I've got a cure for your disease, for whatever ails you, and you won't die, and all you got to do is come and accept it, I'd be kind of foolish not to come and accept it, wouldn't I? And that's really what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying that you can live forever. Now, you're going to exist forever somewhere, but to really live, you need to live in Christ. If any man be in Christ, the Bible said he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I'm getting a little echo back there, if you'd help me just a bit, please. 35th chapter, book of Isaiah. If you're able, would you stand with me for the reading of God's word? Weren't those songs particularly, not that I didn't like the first one, but wasn't that last song, Jesus Messiah, wasn't that just wonderful? Boy, I just stirred my soul, and I hope and pray it did yours. That's what he is. He's the Messiah. He's the Christ. He's the one that has come to set us free and to give us deliverance. This is a short chapter, just 10 verses, so I think I'll just read the whole thing in our hearing, and if you'll follow along while I read aloud. The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellency of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Strengthen ye the weak hands and confirm the feeble knees. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong and fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as an hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. And the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land spring of waters. And in the habitation of dragons, where each lay, shall be grass with reeds and rushes. And an highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, though fools, should not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Thank you. You may be seated. That's a little bit more than I typically read. I declare, just the reading of God's Word, I'd go home after listening to this good singing. But my thoughts kind of go to verse 8 today, and actually more so to verses 6, 5 and 6. But I want to grab a thought from verse 8 and preach to you this morning about the highway of holiness. The highway of holiness. I knew a preacher. He's gone to be with the Lord now. He said when he was first called to preach that God put a thought on his heart about preaching on the highway of holiness. And he said, I had no idea where it was at in the Scripture. And he said, I looked. They didn't have Google like we've got today. They didn't have the mechanism, the technology to hit a button or two and find out where something's at. They had to dig it out the old way. And he said, I just kept putting that off and putting that thought off and putting that thought off. He said, I went to a revival one night, and the preacher read out of Isaiah chapter 35, and he said, I want to preach to you about the highway of holiness. That other preacher said, my jaw fell open. He said, my heart began to yearn to hear what he had to say. And he said, everything that preacher preached was what I had on my heart to preach. And he said, I learned a great lesson. He said, I learned a lesson. If God puts it there, go ahead and preach it, even if you can't find it in Scripture, because it'll be there somewhere. So I want to preach to us this morning about who has the right to be on the highway of holiness and who doesn't. So if you have your Bibles, keep them open for just a few minutes, if you would. And look with me at verse 5. I want to start there. The Bible, and I want you to keep in mind now, the highway of holiness. If you look in verse 5 with me, then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped, and the lame man shall leap as an hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. I want to preach to us this morning about the blind, the deaf, the lame, and the dumb. But I'm not talking about them in a natural sense. Though many things in the Scripture God puts in here in a natural sense for us so that we can understand the spiritual meaning behind it. So when he says here in verse 5 that the eyes of the blind shall be opened, one of my favorite scriptures is about a man named Bartimaeus. And blind Bartimaeus, the Bible said, listen to this, sat by the highway side. He wasn't on the highway, but he was sitting near that place. And he had heard that Jesus was going to pass by. And when he heard that Jesus was going to pass by, he positioned himself. He began to cry out, Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me. Now, I studied a long time ago the word mercy, and one of the definitions of the word mercy is to take yourself out of your body and put yourself in somebody else's position. And no wonder Bartimaeus was crying out for mercy from Jesus, because that's exactly what Jesus did. He came from heaven, laid all of the glory of heaven aside, and came to this earth that he might experience life like you and I experience life. He became a man. So Bartimaeus is by the wayside. And Bartimaeus you just have to bear with me. I get excited. I got excited studying this the other day and started to preach a little bit in my study and realized I was the only one in there besides me and the Lord. And I guess I figured I didn't need it too bad, so I quit. But if you'll stop and think for just a few minutes, here is a blind man. Isaiah talked about the blind receiving their sight. And here's a man that's beside the highway. He's not on the highway, but Jesus is coming this way. Let me tell you something today, precious friend. If you've never been saved by God's grace, if you'll position yourself by the highway, God will make sure that you've got an opportunity to get on this highway of holiness, that you have an opportunity to come to Jesus Christ. It's as simple can be. It is not something that's complicated. Bartimaeus was crying out, and the people around Bartimaeus, just like people today, will say, oh, you don't need religion. They told Bartimaeus, just hold your peace. Don't say a whole lot. Don't cry out. Maybe they were embarrassed. Maybe they didn't want Bartimaeus to put them on the spot. But they said to him, hold your peace. Don't say anything. And he cried out, the Bible said, even louder and louder, Jesus, have mercy on me. Boy, I don't know about you, but I was glad the day that Jesus had mercy on me. I was glad of the day that I came to faith in Christ. And Bartimaeus is there. And finally, the Bible says in the book of Mark, the 10th chapter, and you read this when you get home, but the Bible said that Jesus stood still. I want you to know something. If you're in the depths of your heart, if you'll cry out to God, you'll get the attention of the Lord. The Lord will stand still in all that he has to do, in everything that he's coordinating throughout this great world of ours. The cry of a person that's lost without Christ will grasp the ears of a Savior. He will stop. He will take time for you. And he will listen to you. And when Jesus stood still, the Bible said that he said to them, go call Bartimaeus. You see, there's something that you need to do when the call of salvation comes from God. You need to respond to that call. And listen to what he said to him. He said, the people that went out from Jesus, they said to the blind man, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. So if he was to rise, evidently he was either in a seated position, a kneeling position, maybe laying, maybe couldn't see to get himself around. But they say to him, rise, get up and go to Jesus. It's the most simple thing in the world to do today, and that's to come to Jesus. We have complicated it. We have theologized it. Is that a word? We've just done it so difficult and so simple. But even Isaiah said, though a wayfaring man, though fools would err in this. I'm glad it didn't take a lot to get saved. I'm glad I didn't have the ability to save me, because if I could have saved me, I could unsave me. And if you truly, genuinely are saved by the grace of God, but God hooks you up right, and God makes it everlasting. But I would say to you this morning, Bartimaeus is crying out, and he gets up and he goes to Jesus, and the Bible said, casting away his garment. Do you want the garment of sin to be cast away from you? You've got to be willing to walk away from that to walk to Jesus. And so then he says he came to Jesus, and Jesus asked him a question. First time I ever read this, I thought, what a silly question. Here's a blind man that's crying out to get his eyes opened up, and Jesus said, what do you want me to do for you? Let me tell you something. When you acknowledge to him that you need Him to do what only He can do, and that's to remove your sin that very moment, instantaneously. Boy, you get on television, you know, and they got these healing preachers, and if you're wrapped up in that, just bear with me. But they got these fellas, you know, and they want to heal you. And it's amazing to me that when they come down there, they throw their crutches up on the stage. You've seen all that, right? I would to God that I could heal people. I really do. If I could heal people, you'd never need a crutch again. You'd never need a wheelchair again. And if God heals your soul, you'll never see sin again inside that soul, because it's sealed to the day of redemption. That's what the Bible said. So anyway, let me get off of that and get on to this. Bartimaeus cried out, "Jesus, have mercy on me." And he said, "Lord, I've just got one simple request. Could I see again? Could you open my eyes that I might receive my sight?" And listen to what the Bible said. The King James puts it this way, "and straightway." That means immediately. Immediately his eyes were opened, and he saw Jesus, the Son of God, standing there. Let me tell you, when you have faith in Christ, when you get saved, you'll immediately see Jesus. Now, you won't see him in the flesh. He doesn't walk that way. But you'll see him in the spirit. You'll understand. And so Isaiah talked about the blind man. And then Isaiah talked about the deaf man. I remember in Mark chapter 7 about a deaf man that had an impediment of speech. And when he came to Jesus, Jesus put his fingers in his ears. And Jesus took spittle of his own, and he put it on the tongue of that man. And that man not only could hear, but that man could speak the praises of Almighty God. He opened his ears. Now, you may be here today. I went to the doctor recently, and they did an audiogram. That's a hearing test. And I've got good hearing for the low frequencies. I've got trouble on the high frequencies. That's why I can't hear Vicky half the time. And I have proof now. Praise the Lord. God will convince everything. I mean, God sanctions everything I say. That's about one of the dumbest things I have said, isn't it? Don't you men, you may not have had an audiogram, but you're in the same boat I'm in, so quit laughing at me. So I had this audiogram, and the doctor said, "You can hear the low tones, but you're having trouble with the high tones." And this man was having trouble hearing anything. But just think about when Jesus touched him. Jesus put his fingers in his ears, and immediately he heard birds that were singing, perhaps he'd never heard. He heard the wind going through the trees. He heard the voices of people that he'd never heard before. And the most glorious thing to know is if you're unsaved today, your ears, your spiritual ears, can be unstopped, so that you can hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus. And the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. And then he talked about the lame. I remember an occasion over in the book of Acts, third chapter. You can read this perhaps later on. Peter and John, now this is after the resurrection of Jesus, after Jesus has been ascended back to the Father to be glorified as he originally was. And Peter and John, at the ninth hour of the day, are going into the temple. They're going to church. And here is a man who has been lame from his birth. I take that to mean he's never walked before. Here's a man that's begging, asking alms. He's begging. He's asking, give me just a little bit of money. I have no means of making money for myself and supporting myself and finding food. Would you just put a little something in my tin cup, if you would, in my little basket down here? I need something that'll help me. And all Peter looks at him. And Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Now, if that doesn't excite you, you need to get saved. Here is a man, the Bible said, now leaps to his feet. He jumps up into the air. He's excited. He doesn't care if anybody else around him gets excited. He can do something now that he's never been able to do before. Let me tell you something. You can't walk on this highway of holiness that I'm preaching about unless you've been saved by God's grace. Unless your eyes have been opened and your ears have been opened. And then finally, he talks about the dumb singing. The dumb. And now dumb doesn't mean without knowledge. It means the inability to speak. And so here's a man, same fella back in Mark chapter 7, where Jesus put his fingers in his ears. Jesus takes some spittle from his mouth and he puts it on his tongue. You say, well, that seems kind of gross. Let me tell you the spiritual application of that. Jesus took his word and put it in his mouth. When Jesus put his word in his mouth, he could proclaim Jesus as the Son of the living God. Jesus asked his disciples on one occasion, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they had all kinds of answers for him. Then he said, but who do you say that I am? I want to ask you that same question this morning. Who do you say that Jesus is? Oh, is Jesus just a good man? Was he just a good teacher? Was he just somebody that had good morals? But Peter had the best answer of them all. He said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. If in your heart today you'd acknowledge that. So who walks on this highway? The blind that have had their sight restored. The deaf that have their ears unstopped. I'm talking spiritually now. And the lame that can now walk in the presence of Almighty God. And those that have never been able to speak are now praising the Son of God. If you read on in Isaiah, one of the last verses I read to you said this, and the redeemed shall walk there. That's us, folks. To be redeemed means to be bought back, to be purchased. And sin had us captive. It may have some of you captive today. You may be the best moral person in the world, but without Jesus, sin has you captive today. But oh, I'm glad to tell you that Jesus Christ has come to set the captive free. He's come to redeem us. He's come to purchase us, and he's already done so at Calvary. And so now I want to focus for just a moment on who cannot walk on this highway. If you remember what I read, the scripture said, no lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall not be found there. The New Testament talks about Satan as a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he may devour. And folks, the goal of Satan is twofold. If you've never been saved, what he wants to do is to blind you to the gospel, to blind you to the Word of God that would help you come to faith in Christ. That's his job. In other words, let me say it this way. His job is to keep you out of heaven. And if you are saved, his job is to shut your mouth so that you can't tell the praises of God to anybody else to keep them out of heaven. That's really what it boils down to. That's really what this is all about. No ravenous beast can walk there. When you're on the highway of holiness, you say, well, there's times I get discouraged. You know why you get discouraged? If this aisle is the highway of holiness, if you stay in the middle of this and you walk that straight and narrow, but sometimes we kind of drift off over this way, don't we? Every now and then. And we're just getting closer to listening to the voice of the evil one. Sometimes we just walk over this way. But if we'll stay right in the center of God's will and lift up his name and glorify him, no ravenous beast can walk there. You're safe when you're on this highway of holiness, according to what I read in Isaiah. That's enough. And please. You know what I'm going to do? How about the choir, real fast, as quickly as you can get here, come back. And I want you to sing that song one more time. You say, that'll be the third time we've sung it. That'd be all right. Because I want you to hear how Jesus is the Messiah. The Messiah means the Christ, the Anointed One. He's God's chosen that has come to this earth to give you life and life everlasting. When you're ready, just go get started. But I want to ask you a question this morning. Are you here today and you've never placed your faith in Christ? I'm going to ask you to do that today. I'm going to encourage you to do that. I'm going to try to help you to do that. I'll do anything I can to try to help you come to faith in Jesus Christ. Because you see, as we were reminded this week, this life is but a vapor. James said we appear for a little while, then we're vanished away. If you live to be 100, it's just an eye blink in eternity. If you live to be 120, back in biblical days, they lived to be 900 and some years old, just a blink in eternity. What are you going to do with Jesus? Because one of these days, you're going to stand before the Lord. Judgment has been given to Him. And He won't judge you on whether you came to church. He won't judge you on your morals. He won't judge you on your baptisms. He won't judge you on your church membership, even though those things are important. But He's going to be looking for one thing when you stand before Almighty God. He's looking for the blood of Jesus. Have you accepted my Son as your personal Savior? That's like the doctor saying, I've got the remedy. All you need to do is come get it. All you need to do is come get it. Let me tell you this, and then they can sing. I want you to think about this real closely. God Almighty has done everything He can do for your salvation. He set a plan up before this world was ever formed. Jesus Christ has done everything He can do for your salvation. He went to Calvary. He died in your place. God raised Him from the dead. And He now offers you everlasting, eternal life. The Holy Spirit does everything He can do. He's doing that right now in your life, because this moment that you're feeling, you're sensing a sense of guilt, a sense of uneasiness. You'll never go to the doctor if you don't have a symptom of what's ailing you. And that's what conviction is. Conviction means to convince you. And that's the job of the Holy Spirit, to convince you. It's not my job. My job is just to share the message with you. But it's the Holy Spirit's job to trouble your heart. And then it's the church's responsibility to pray. And I trust and pray that we've done that this morning. But then there's one other personality that's involved in all of this before salvation can take place, and that's you. Because God can do all He's done. Christ can do everything He's done. The Holy Spirit can bring conviction. The church can pray, but unless you're willing to believe, it won't happen. It just won't happen. But the very moment that you place your faith in Jesus, instantaneously, immediately, you can rise up and walk. Let's sing. Choir, sing it like you've never sung it before. Allow the Holy Spirit to move in your heart that it might touch people's lives. I encourage you to come. Maybe you're here and you've been saved. Maybe God's touched your heart in this and said, I want your life rededicated to me. It'd be a good time for you to come. You do what God lays on your heart to do. Listen. Be honored to pray with you. I'd like for you to come. We're going to be dismissed, but if you've got a question about salvation, about Jesus, not that others can't, but these can answer your question. So I'm just going to walk away. We're going to come to dismission. We're going to end. Nick, how about you coming? Would you come? Come on. You've never heard a testimony until you've heard his. They can help you. They're not biblical scholars. All I'd like them to do is, if you've got a question, as we're being dismissed, I want them to linger. And as they linger, if you want to just come to one of them, ask them a question. The Apostle Paul, every time he had an opportunity, he didn't get theological on people. He just simply told them what happened to him when he had an encounter with Jesus. That's what these folks can do, because they've had an encounter with Jesus. Now, if I didn't call you up here, it's not because I don't think you can do that. I just felt impressed to call these folks. And so we're going to be dismissed. And as we go out, if you've got questions and you're lingering, just linger a little while and come talk to one of these folks. If you want to talk to me, I'll be out there. I'll be glad to go off to the side with you, talk with you, come back in here with you, whatever you want to do. But if I know anything about the Holy Spirit, he touched somebody's heart today, probably more than one. And he gave you opportunity. And what you do with that opportunity is up to you. I pray you'll come to him, because I have found him to be the best thing I ever did in my life. I have a wife that I love. She's not the best thing I ever did. I've got a son and a daughter and 6 grandsons. That's not the best thing I ever did. Best thing I ever did was to come to Jesus. Best thing I ever did was to give my heart and my life to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And if you'll do that, you'll never be the same. You'll say, I don't want to change. Then don't come to Jesus, because he'll change you. Amen. He'll change you. You know what? When we change, you know what we have a tendency to do? We want to comb our hair different. We want to change from the outside. But when you come to Jesus, he starts on the inside. And he'll change you inwardly. If any person, any man, woman, boy, or girl is in Christ Jesus, he's a new creation. Aren't you glad of that today? I'm new. I got saved almost 60 years ago, and I'm new in the Lord as I walk with him. As I dismiss you today, maybe some of you would just linger and say, I don't feel like going out there and talking. I want to talk to the Master on behalf of somebody that might want Jesus. You do what God impresses your heart to do. And I guarantee you, if you'll do your part, the Holy Spirit will keep doing his part. God bless you. You're at liberty to go.